You're watching Northwest Sports Tonight, brought to you by McDonald's. Did you know many of your favorite choices at McDonald's are under 400 calories? Come see for yourself. McDonald's. I'm loving it.
About threw it by him.
3-2. Breaking ball struck him out. This guy's on a roll.
Danny Farquhar might be the only highlight of tonight's Mariners game. If you see the score up there, you know what I mean. More on that in a few. One day after addressing the alleged DUI, the Seahawks cut quarterback Josh Portis. Much more from Hawks HQ. The feel-good story of the day, former Sonic Kevin Durant makes a massive donation for tornado relief in Oklahoma City. We'll hear from KD in a few. Welcome to Northwest Sports Tonight. NBA playoffs coming up as well. And just how close was Phil Jackson to coming to Seattle? Had the NBA returned to the Northwest? Well, the Zen Master tells us in a few. Mariners head to Anaheim after a season-high 4 straight losses, all coming in Cleveland. Aaron Harang gets the start. He has not fared well against the Angels, 0-2 with a 6.11 ERA. Tonight, his troubles with the Angels continue. Angels already up 1-0 in the first. Josh Hamilton tags him for a 2-run homer. Everything unravels for Harang in the fourth inning. He gives up a home run, 2 doubles, and 2 triples. Teams don't get that in an entire game. He got that in an inning. This one of Mike Trout. Angels take a 7-0 lead with Trout's triple. Harang pulled after a rough night. And struggle on offense as Jerome Williams does everything right for the Angels. Holds the M's to single digits in hits. In the sixth, Angels load the bases. Trout drives one deep, clears them. Angels add to that lead. Big time. Boy. It is just a disaster out there in Anaheim. As we mentioned earlier, rough night for Harang. Gives up a whole lot of hits. 9 hits, 7 runs, all earned in 3-plus innings of work. It didn't take the Seahawks long to take a stand against their third-string quarterback. The Hawks waived Josh Portis a day after news surfaced of his DUI arrest. Portis was one of 3 players competing for the Hawks' backup quarterback job. That leaves Brady Quinn and Gerard Johnson to battle for the spots. In terms of the starting quarterback, Russell Wilson is ready to go. He added 5 pounds to his legs in the offseason and hopes that added strength will increase his mobility. Wilson says knowing he's the starter has already made these OTAs much different.
You know, leadership role is already established, I think, also, you know, and then also just the reps. You know, last year I was splitting, you know, a third of the reps all the way through August pretty much, so. You know, I think that'll give me a little of a boost and get me ready for the season, and I'm excited about that. We got a great offense.
While these OTAs are voluntary, one player not at Seahawks headquarters yet is Marshawn Lynch. And while Pete would like to see him on the field, he says he's okay with the offseason course Lynch is taking.
There's a lot of fun. There's a lot of good stuff happening here.
And he's
in very good shape. He came in 10 days ago and was in really good shape. He's working on a really intense program in his area, and he's benefiting from it.
Sounders midfielder Brad Evans has been called in by the U.S. national team. He will play in the 3 World Cup qualifiers in June, including the Panama match at CenturyLink Field. Like Eddie Johnson, Evans will miss the Chivas USA and Vancouver matches.
Certain vibes, certain emotions that you get from that. And there's a lot of hard work that goes into it. And when you see it doesn't go unnoticed, that it's a little bit special. You know, I think guys have done well enough in MLS to, you know, prove themselves. So there's always the aspiration to go overseas and prove yourself there. But if you're getting called out for a World Cup and you're playing in MLS, you've got to be doing something good.
Injury update from the Sounders. Ozzie Alonso will most likely sit out Sunday's game against the Galaxy. The midfielder suffered a groin injury Saturday against Dallas. Leo Gonzalez is good to go. Ziggy said Leo got some stitches after getting bloodied up over the weekend. Unlike the NFL, where a draft order is based on records, the NBA does it a little differently. Tonight, 10 teams found out how they'll stack up in the draft with the annual lottery.
The second pick will be made by the Orlando Magic. Yes! Yes! And that means the number one pick in the 2013 NBA draft goes to the Cleveland Cavaliers.
So there you have it. The Cavs get the first pick, followed by the Magic and the Wizards. The Blazers walk away with the 10th pick in the 2013 draft. The NBA draft, June 27th. In the Western Conference Finals, game two between the Spurs and Grizzlies. Fast forward to the fourth, Tony Parker nails a three. But the Grizzlies climb back from 18 down and tie it up with 18 seconds left. Mike Conley drills it, 3 seconds left in the game. Tim Duncan tries a three, no good. Greg Popovich not happy with that choice. They go to overtime. Duncan redeems himself, scores 6 points for the Spurs in OT. San Antonio wins 93-89, taking a 2-0 lead in the series. Last week on the Tonight Show, Phil Jackson discussed his relationship with Chris Hansen. Jackson goes farther on today's Dan Patrick Show, saying he had an agreement with Hansen if the Sonics came back.
I thought he was dynamic. I thought he had great ideas. You know, he went through the whole process of getting an arena. I mean, he did everything right, except, you know, win the franchise. But, you know, his I think vision I could buy into. I thought he had the right vision for a team. And, you know, he made basically the offer of take what you want to take as a job. A consultant, if you want to be an owner, be part owner, be a consultant. You'll work in the basketball operations side of it if you want to. Or coach, you know, I mean, it didn't matter to him.
Kevin Durant has always been a class act, and it continues with the former Sonic donating $1 million to Oklahoma's tornado relief efforts. That million was matched by the Thunder, along with the NBA and Players Association. When asked about it, Durant said it didn't have anything to do with being the first one to donate.
God told me to, you know, do something to help these families out, and that's the first thing I thought of. It's the first thing he popped in my mind, so... you know, I'm just trying to do anything I can to help. It's such a tough situation. Some of those things you can't get back. You know, but I just try to help the families out as much as I can.
Now for the McDonald's moment of the day. Did you know many of your favorite choices at McDonald's are under 400 calories? Come see for yourself.
Check out this goal. Parma on the free kick. They send it across, and look at the rocket from Massimo Gabbia. That is a ridiculously tough shot. Take another look. He hammers it off the volley, nails it on the fly, and buries it in the back of the nets. That takes home tonight's McDonald's moment. Coming up, former Seahawk Orlando Huff gives us a player's perspective on the off-field troubles plaguing the Seahawks. And if you've been wondering how taking Adderall gives players an edge, we've got some more information there. Plus, an NFC West rival city gets the opportunity to host a Super Bowl.
I want to say, keep on peeping on Phil Sylvie. It's Paul Sylvie.
Why not get Paul?
So, Paul, what's on your mind?
Actually, it's Phil.
You mean it's not Paul?
No, it's Phil.
What's the difference? Come on, spit it out.
Paul Sylvie. That's the name. Northwest TV is his game.
The Seahawks' off-field troubles overshadowed the first day of OTAs. Based on an NFL policy put in place back in 2008, the team will be fined if there's another suspension under the substance abuse policy during the 2013 year. This means the Hawks most likely paid more than $60,000 for suspensions last year. Three Seahawks were suspended in 2012, Alan Barbary, Winston Guy, and Brandon Browner. Based on the league's policy, that means the Seahawks faced fines for the second and third suspension. The NFL declined to comment on whether this is true, but this policy does make you wonder. Will general managers and coaches be more careful now and steer clear from players who carry the red flag of possible violations? Let's get a player's perspective now and bring in former Seahawks linebacker Orlando Huff. Orlando, you see some of the suspensions the Seahawks have had of late, especially this one with Bruce Irvin. What's your reaction?
I mean, that to me, that's just straight stupidity. You got two guys that obviously basically, well, since Sherman got off, I mean, Browner got suspended, you know, a few games for it. And then you go and do the same thing. That's just, to me, just immaturity and foolishness. We're grown men. You know, you have to police yourself. You can't, you know, Coach Carroll cannot hold your hand in every situation. And like I said, I believe guys make mistakes. I mean, you get supplements thrown at us left and right. You know, I mean, I did when I was playing, and I know it's probably 4 or 5 times worse. Football is a brutal sport, and you have to be you know, on top of your supplements and nutrition to make sure you have the longevity and the career that you want to have. These guys don't really know. They know the benefits of Adderall, but I don't think they know the, you know, repercussions of this drug, you know. The repercussions of this drug is something serious they need to really be thinking about long term.
You know, you look at these suspensions, what kind of effect can they have on teammates in the locker room?
I mean, you're a family in that locker room. I don't care what you go through. I mean, there's guys that go through personal issues, guys go through, issues with family, wives, everything else. And what happens in that locker room stays amongst us, because when it comes down to it, when that guy gets off his suspension, he's going to be there fighting on the gridiron with you. You don't want to ever have no ill will towards a guy just because he made a mistake. No one's perfect. You know, you're a band of brothers when you're in that locker room. It's just period. Guys are not going to always make the right decisions. What you do is, you know, the older veterans will coach them up and say, look, man, this is not what we need right now. We're trying to build something special here. But they won't turn their back on them or nothing like that. That's not a team. And that's one thing about Coach Carroll. He has a good hold on the locker room. And, you know, so when it's all said and done, your character is the only thing that you're going to be left with once you're done playing football, and that's going to define you throughout your life.
Those are definitely good points. How about the perception of this Seahawks team? You look at the suspensions and the fact that they are under the microscope and definitely in the spotlight because there's so much expected of this Hawks team, and certainly one of the Super Bowl favorites.
Overall, to me, it's not a reflection on the team. Yeah, they done have some incidents, and like I said, when you're winning, of course you're going to get that magnifying glass on you. So you got to understand that everything's going to get magnified. Even though this is wrong, you're not setting an example for, you know, some of these younger kids, but these guys got to understand you got to take the good with the bad and rebound from it and get ready for the season. They have, you know, they've been favored to win the Super Bowl, so you already know anything that they do that is not conducive to winning or football or that image, then they're gonna get the wrath of the media. And like I said, Bruce needs to wake up and understand that this is life. You're gonna get a lot of scrutiny for the things you do from this point on.
That's good perspective from former Seahawk Orlando Huff joining us tonight. Hey, thanks a lot, Orlando. We appreciate it.
All right, thanks, Paul. Talk to you soon.
Doctors prescribe Adderall to people with attention deficit disorder. So what kind of edge can it give an NFL player? It increases alertness, aggressiveness, attention, and concentration. It improves reaction time, especially when fatigued. Some even think it enhances hand-eye coordination and increases the mental aspects of performance. Adderall can also disconnect mental from physical fatigue, which can help an athlete push through tiredness. It's also a cognitive enhancement, which can help in learning playbooks or developing strategy.
By vote of the NFL clubs, Super Bowl 50 in 2016 has been awarded to San Francisco.
Good news today for two cities. Super Bowl 50 will be played in the 49ers' brand new stadium in 2016. The only previous Super Bowl played in Northern California was Stanford Stadium 28 years ago. Houston will host Super Bowl 51. Up next, the inspirational story of a former college basketball star fighting for the chance to walk unassisted. If you're still disappointed over the Kings' relocation vote, we have something that just might cheer you up. It involves several former Huskies, including Nate Robinson and Brandon Roy. Stay with us. Well, the Sonics are no longer in town, but that doesn't stop the city of Seattle from being represented in the NBA. Former Washington Huskies Nate Robinson and Brandon Roy have taken their games to another level. Both have now decided to return to join other former UW basketball stars for an alumni game next month. The event will feature a Legends game, a slam dunk contest, and a lot of other festivities. The University of Washington men's basketball alumni event will take place on June 23rd, Heck Edmondson Pavilion, open to the public. Tickets cost $15. Children under 12 will get in free. 5 years ago, he was a force on the basketball court. A little more than 5 months ago, he could barely move his body. But with rehab and groundbreaking transplant surgery, a Tigered man is up and moving again. Michael Burke has the story.
Arion Moore has set a goal with a deadline. That's because his best friend is getting married this summer.
I told him that, you know, I don't want to be in the going down the aisle, but if I could use a cane, I'll consider it.
It's hard to determine which is more unbelievable, that as recently as Thanksgiving, Arian could barely move, or that as recently as 5 years ago, this was Arian playing basketball for Southern Oregon University. A 6'6" high wire act, grounded when the autoimmune disease scleroderma began to ravage his body from the inside out.
No one knows. It just came out of the air, as far as I know.
But it's something that happened in midair, which led Arian to the nearest physician.
He dunked on me, and I was nowhere near touching the ball, and I just said, this is not normal.
That was 2008. By 2011, he was still walking with the help of a cane. But by last summer, he couldn't even uncoil his body.
My hands was fully contracted. My legs were bent. I could barely open my mouth.
This was not going to get better on its own. But he found what may have been a solution in Chicago. In the Windy City, he was blown away by hope.
There's no cure, and everything is still trial, pretty much like the stem cell transplant, but from reading what they have done, it was the best option. Ever since then, all I thought about was, okay, now I can get back into work, I can start playing ball.
The stem cell transplant surgery has helped immensely, so has intense physical therapy. The Tigard resident is now an inpatient at Good Samaritan in Northwest Portland. He's not all the way back yet, really misses playing hoops. Misses his job as a counselor working with adult and youth criminal offenders. But there is one thing he is determined not to miss.
I have also another good teammate who's, I guess, second best friend. He's getting married in North Carolina in September. I might be able to walk for his.
Best of luck to Arian. He will remain an inpatient for the rest of this month. He said he'd like to walk out of that hospital on his own. June is National Scleroderma Month. Back to the pitch, Seattle Sounders will have a new MLS opponent in the near future. Major League Soccer announcing today the New York Yankees and England's Manchester City have teamed up to acquire an MLS club. The expansion team will be called the New York City Football Club, and they're expected to start play 2015. Now to the ice. Winter Hawks are in excellent shape in the Memorial Cup despite a 1-1 record. That's because a win last night, coupled with a Halifax loss, has put Portland on the cusp of playing for the championship. All the Winter Hawks need to do now is beat Saskatoon tomorrow. But beating the host team won't be easy.
They're a good team. I mean, they showed last night how well they can play. I got a lot of respect for their team. I really felt like at the start of our playoffs this year that they were one of the teams that could come out of the East. They've got an older group over there that work hard. They're a bigger team.
Coming up, some high school hops. You'll see what I mean right here. The best of the rest as well. Stay with us.
Now, the catch of the week. Brought to you by Westport on the Washington coast. Not far, but a world away.
While fishing on a charter boat out of Westport, Adam Ruffeld of Aberdeen caught this 52-pound halibut, which won him the Derby prize for the day of $500. He made the catch on the last halibut day of the year. And in day two of the Sterling Bank Open, Matt Cowell takes the lead, shooting a 69 today. He moves to 7-under in the tournament. Sterling Bank of Washington Open Invitational, and the drive for the cure benefits the Seattle Cancer Care Alliance and prostate cancer research. High school baseball, watch the runner coming home. He hurdles the catcher, flies to the plate, and touches home. He's in there. Warning to catchers. This is happening all over the country. Wake up. Hey, there's a new world record for pogo stick backflips. I know. We've been waiting a while for this. 15 is the new mark. Pirates fans have endured 20 straight losing seasons, so anytime they get a gift, they deserve it. This guy uses his hat to make the catch at his one strong bill in the Steel City. And finally, Bruins and Rangers. Watch the puck bounce off goalie Henrik Lundqvist before he can find it. Daniel Paille knocks it in with 3.5 minutes left to win it for the Bruins 2-1. They lead the series now 3-0. See you tomorrow night.
West Sports Tonight. Brought to you by McDonald's. Did you know many of your favorite choices at McDonald's are under 400 calories? Come see for yourself. McDonald's. I'm loving it.